This conference will now be recorded.
Yeah, let's start. So in the last class, we have seen how to create a drop-down list works in what? A selection screen. Okay, so let me open that. Yeah, so this is the example we have discussed. So what was the requirement? On the selection screen, we have prepared a drop-down list box which contains some three values. Okay, and we understood that every value in the drop-down list box will be associated with a key. Key is used for identifying which value is selected in the runtime. So our requirement is that the user is going to select one of the value. When I click on the button, okay, I have displayed the selected value from the list box. So I selected OOPSAVAP, so it is displaying what OOPSAVAP is what selected. Okay, so let me show you one more example on drop down list box with a slight change. See here, this is a requirement. Our selection screen should contain a drop down list box. Okay, it should contain some three values like courses, institutes, and locations. Courses, institutes, and locations. And every value in the drop-down list box should have a key. So assume that I am going to associate the keys as K1, K2, and what? K3. You can give any keys. I gave it as K1, K2, K3. And your selection screens should contain three blocks. Okay, our selection screen should contain what? Three blocks. Block 1, block 2, block 3. Block 1 should contain checkboxes. Block 2, radio buttons. And block 3 should contain some text. Okay. So here the validation is these three blocks should be invisible by default. These three blocks means when the selection screen is displayed, initially these three blocks should not be displayed. It should be invisible. In the runtime, when I select any value, okay, suppose if I select institute, this institute's block should be what? Made visible depending on the selected value. If I select courses, this courses block should be made visible. If I select locations what block should be made visible. Initially, all these three blocks are invisible. So in the earlier case, what you are doing is, in the earlier example, when we have executed this, we are selecting the value. When I select the value, nothing is happening. After clicking on the button only, we have written the logic to identify the selected value and we have displayed the message. Here my requirement is what? The moment I select any value, the appropriate block should be made visible. So here the agenda is we are trying to understand how to make the screen elements visible, invisible based on the user interaction. That is a requirement. Okay. So let's see how to do it. I hope my voice is clear to everyone. Okay. Done. So let's see this. One second. Yeah, so I'll give the title of the program. Drop down list box on selection screen. Type of program is executable program. I'll save it in the local object. Just hold on. Okay, I've just refreshed the server. Right, so what is the requirement? First, let us focus on what? How to create the drop-down list box. Already we know how to create the drop-down list box. So parameters, I'll give the name of the list box as p_abc type. I'll give something p_abc of 15 type C as what? List box. Okay. p_abc of 15 type C as list box. So when I execute this, check for the syntax errors. I got an error. The as list box addition can only be used with what? Visible length. So already we have seen this error. So I need to use option what? Visible length. What is the total width of the list box? 15. But the visible length I'll get as something 12. Okay. Let me execute this. So when I execute, I got the what? Selection screen which contains what? A drop down list box. Done. Now what I'll do is fine. What is the next requirement here? I need to associate the values with this particular drop down list box. So what is the first event triggered? Initialization event, right? In the initialization event, let us write the logic to associate the values and display the drop down. So last class we have seen, in order to do that, we have to use one function model. What is the function model we are using? vrm underscore set underscore values. So if you go to function builder SC37, we have a function model VRM underscore set underscore values. VRM stands for value request manager. So we need to call this particular function module to display the drop down list box, or to associate the values with the drop down list box. What is the signature of this function module? If you go to the import section, it has got two parameters. Both the parameters are what? Mandatory. Optional checkbox is not selected, so they are mandatory. First parameter is ID, which is expecting the name of the list box. In our case, what is the name of the list box? P underscore ABC is the name of the list box. What is the other mandatory parameter? Values type VRM underscore values. So by looking at this, we don't know what data type it is. If you double click on this, it is taking the control to something called as what, type group. There is one database object, one dictionary object called as what, type group VRM. Inside this, we have VRM underscore values. It is of type what? VRM underscore value occurs what? Zero. Already I told in the last class, wherever we see occurs keyword, you have to understand that as what? Internal table. So internal table means you will have fields. Na? What are the fields in that? This VRM underscore values is of type VRM underscore value. If I double click on VRM underscore value, VRM underscore value is the types declaration available within the same type group VRM. This types declaration contains two fields. One is key, another is what? Text. Already I told every value in the dropdown will have what? Key. So you need to provide the key for this field, and there's a text is nothing but the value. Both are what? Character fields. So what you have to do now, we need to prepare an internal table of what type? VRM underscore value, and then pass that internal table as a value to this particular parameter. So I can say this parameter is what? Internal table. So let me declare the internal table first. Already we have the types declaration, which is provided by what? SAP itself. If I double click once again, VRM underscore value is a types declaration available in the type group VRM. So let me create the internal table based on that. So I'll say here, I'll say data T underscore values type table of VRM underscore value. Okay. Then I require a work area to prepare the internal table. So I'll say W underscore value type VRM underscore value. So when we are declaring our own internal table, we are creating types declaration. Based on the types declaration, we used to create the internal table and work area. Now in this case, the types declaration is given by what? SAP itself. So when I do syntax check, I don't have any errors. But in the older versions, I told it may not recognize this. It will give an error saying that the type VRM underscore value is what? Unknown. So at that time, what you have to do? This VRM underscore value is a types declaration defined in the type group what? VRM. Okay, so whenever we are using the components of the type group, whenever we are using the components of the type group in your program, we need to declare the type group by using what keyword? Type pools. Type pools VRM. Okay, so this statement is required if you're working in what 6.0 or less than 6.0. But from EHP versions, this declaration not required. Okay, so I'll just give a comment once again. Required in what? Older version. So since this is EHP version, even if I don't declare it, it will recognize. Done. So in the initialization event, I need to prepare the values and associate the values. So let me write that logic inside a subroutine. Perform, I'll use a subroutine name and not something, prepare values. Let me double click on the subroutine. Subroutine does not exist. Create the object. I'll create that in the main program. So I need to prepare the internal table. So already we have seen that logic. So what is the work area declared? W underscore value. What are the fields in the type declaration? Key and what? Text. So I'll say W underscore value hyphen key equal to, you can give any keys. I'll give the keys as K1. What are the values you want to associate? Courses, institutes and what? Location. So I'll say W underscore value hyphen what? Text is equal to, I'll give something courses, then I'll append it. Append W underscore value to t underscore values k1, k2. This I'll give it as something institutes, done. And then k3, I'll give the third value as something what, locations, done. So I prepared an internal table with what, three values. So we are done with what, internal table. Internal table is ready. So I need to call that function model now by passing values for those two mandatory importing parameters. We don't have any other parameter here. All these parameters are not available. Done. It might raise the exception. If anything goes wrong, it will raise its exception. We need to handle it. So what I'll do now, here I'll call the function model. I'll go to pattern, call function. What is that? VRM underscore set underscore values. Import becomes export. ID. What do you have to pass for this ID? ID is what? Name of the value set, nothing but name of the list box which is holding the values. In our case, what is the name of the list box? P underscore ABC. What kind of data type it is? If you observe this one, okay, if I double click on VRM underscore ID, it is of type what? VRM underscore value hyphen text. If I double click on this, this text is what type? Character. Since it is character, I need to provide that in what, single quote. So whenever I'm referring to the name in single quotes, you have to give the name. What is the name here? P underscore ABC. Done. Then values. You have to pass the internal table now. What is the internal level I prepared? T underscore values. Exceptions. Okay. If this exception is raised, size of ours is set to 1. If some other exception is raised, size of ours is set to what? 2. So I'll just uncomment this and handle that. So what I'll say, if size of bars is equal to 1, I'll just give the message exception ID illegal name raised, type what, information message, else if what, size of bars is equal to 2. Else if size of bars equal to 2, I'll just give a message what, unknown exception, type what, I. If the function model is successfully executed, size of bars remains what, 0. Means if it is successfully executed, means it would have successfully associated the values with the drop down. So when I execute this, okay, so the first event triggered whenever a selection screen is about to display what, initialization event. In the initialization event, we are calling one user defined subroutine where we are preparing the list of values and associating the list of values with our drop down list box. How do we associate that? By calling one standard function model, VRM underscore set underscore values. So when I execute, right, so now yes, I'm having what, 3 values. So this part, anyhow, we have discussed in the last class also how to call this particular function model. What are the other elements we require on the selection screen? We require some 3 blocks. So let me quickly construct the selection screen blocks. Okay, so first I'll construct the block 1, which should contain what, checkboxes. So somewhere here, events are handled where? At the end of the program. Subroutines are defined where? At the end of the program. So somewhere here, I'll create the block. So selection screen, already we know how to design the blocks. Begin of block, I'll give the block name as BK1. I'll say with frame, title what? Title variable I'll give T1. Then I'll say selection screen, end of block BK1, what? End of block BK1. So I'm trying to create the block. Inside this block, what we require? I require checkboxes. So I'll say parameters. Already we know how to design the checkboxes also. So I'll as checkbox. Then I'll say P underscore C2 as checkbox. Then I'll say P underscore C3 as checkbox. So I've created 3 checkboxes. So when I execute this, yes, I got the block. Now for this block, what is the title variable I give? T1. Let me initialize in the initialization event. So T1 is equal to, I'll say something courses. So when I execute, yes, I got the title there. Let me give some meaningful text for the checkboxes. How to give? Go to text element, selection text. Already we know this. P underscore C1, I'll say something ABAP. P underscore C2, I'll say something, sorry. P underscore C2, I'll give something. P underscore C3, I'll say something UI5. Let me save it, activate this. Done. When I execute, yes, I got the done. Then I require what? One more block. So let me design one more block. So I'll just copy this. Selection screen, begin of block. I'll give the block name as BK2. Title, I'll give it as T2. I want the radio button. So already we know how to design the radio buttons. Okay, all these radio buttons should belong to a single group so that the user can select only one radio button. So how to do it? Radio button group, I'll give the group name as G1. P underscore R2, R3, I'll give the group name as GRP1, block name is what? BK2. Okay, what is the title variable I give? T2. So I'll give T2 is equal to something what? Institutes. Done. Okay. Activate this. Let me give the selection text. Right, so when I execute, I got what? Second block. Then I require one more block now. Let me design one more block. Begin of block, I'll give the title variable as T3, block is BK3. What I want in the third block, some labels. Okay, so here how to design the labels, already we know. Selection screen, comment. I'll start the label from sixth position. I'll give some 15 spaces. Okay, 6 of 15. I'll give the what? A label variable name as something LB1. Okay, then again, I want the next label in the new line. So I'll say slash, which indicates new line. I'll give LB2, LB3, and again here also I'll give what? Slash. What is the block variable name? 3. Done. So title variable, I'll give it as T3 is equal to something. Locations. Done. Okay, fine. Then I'll give the text for the labels also. So I'll say something LB1. Okay, some text I'll give. Done. So I'm just giving some labels. So I got three labels. Fine. Okay. Right. So let me start this labels from third position so that it will be properly aligned. Done. Okay. So I got something like this. Fine. But what is the requirement here? The requirement is when the selection screen is displayed. Okay. Yes, the selection screen is displayed now. Initially, these three blocks should be what? Invisible. These three blocks should be invisible. Something like this. Okay, something like this here. Suppose, try to focus here. See, just observe here. When I'm trying to create any program, okay, when I'm trying to create any program in SC38, observe here. Here you can observe in this screen. We have four fields here: type, status, application, authorization, group. Okay, only four input fields are there: type, status, application, authorization, group. This is nothing but a drop down. Now in the drop down, I'll choose executable program. So if I choose executable program, see what happens. Two more fields are made visible. Initially, by default, they are invisible. Now they are made what? Visible. The moment I choose the executable program, what are the two additional fields? Logical database and selection screen. If I choose include program, again they made what invisible. So depending on the value I select, depending on the value I select in my drop down list box, the appearance of the screen is getting changed. So let's see how to do the same thing. So in my case also, initially these three blocks should be made invisible. Okay, so let us understand how to control the appearance of the screen. Okay, so before I continue, any questions here, please ask me. Done. So there are no questions. Fine. So now to understand how to control the appearance of the screen, okay, we need to use a structure called as what? Screen structure. We have to use one structure called as what? Screen structure. So already we know how to create the structures. A structure is nothing but what? It's a collection of what? Fields, nothing but a work area. Okay, we are creating the structures in your program. So they are local. They are available only within the program. Similarly, we have some global structures. We have some global structures. Global structure means which are available in the database. Okay, so how do we access that database objects? We have a T code, what? SE11. Okay, we have a T code called as SE11. Nothing but what? ABAP dictionary. Okay, so by using this SC11, I can access all the dictionary objects, nothing but database objects. Okay, so let me go to SC11. So if I go to SC11, right, so all this is nothing but what? Dictionary objects, nothing but database objects, means they get stored in what? Database. Okay, they get stored in the database. So if I choose this data type, I'll select the data type radio button. We have one structure. We have one database structure given by what? SAP. Database structure means it is available in the database. So what is the structure name? Screen. You can see it. It is not starting with Z or Y. So you have to understand that as what? Standard object. So it's a standard structure given by what? SAP. So I'll choose data type, provide screen. Since it is standard, I cannot modify. If I display this, you can see here, it is showing me what structure. It is nothing but what structure, nothing but what collection of what fields. How many fields it has got? Some 17 fields. Component is nothing but what fields. What are the names of the fields? Name, group 1, group 2, group 3, group 4, so on, so on. So your understanding should be, there is one database structure called as screen, provided by whom? SAP itself. So why we are discussing this structure means, based on this structure, SAP will create an internal table. Whenever we execute any program, during the program execution, okay, an internally created internal table will be available. I repeat once again, during the execution of every program, an internally created internal table is available. Internally created means we will create that by SAP itself. So internal table means what? It should contain fields. So what is the structure of that internal table? SAP will create the internal table based on what? Screen structure means SAP will contain the internal with how many fields? 17 fields. I repeat, during the execution of every program, an internally created internal table is available, called as what? Screen internal table. Okay, that internal table is created based on what? Screen structure. So what you have to understand is, when I execute this program, during the program, this program execution also, one internally created internal table will be available, called as what? Screen internal table. So what that screen internal table will contain? Observe here. So it contains both default header and what? Body. So assume that this is your header of that internal table. This is the header of the internal table, and this is the body of the internal table. This is the body of the internal table. Okay, what are the fields in that? You'll have many fields here. Just try to understand. This internal table, I'll be using in many places for the rest of the course. We'll be using it in many areas in the rest of the topics. So this is your default header. This is your body of the internal table. So my internal table, this internal table will be created by SAP with one default header. Default work area. Okay, so this is a body and the above one is a header, default header. Okay, so body means what? Obviously, it contains what? Many records. Done. So what are the fields in this internal table? This internal table is created based on what structure? Screen structure. What is the first field here? Name. Then we have group 1, group 2, group 4, all those things. So the first field is what here? Name. Next is what? Group 1 it seems. Next is what? Group 2 it seems. Okay. Next is what? Group 3 it seems. Next is what? Group 4 it seems. What is the next field here after this? Required input, output, etc., etc. Required, this is input, and this is what? Output, or space is not sufficient. I'll say blah, 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 etc. Let me take some of the fields which is necessary for us. Okay, we have intensified, invisible, length, all those things. Okay, so assume this is invisible. Okay, like this. How many fields overall? 17 fields. Okay, what is the last field here? What is the last field? Color it seems. So here, color. So overall, how many fields was? 17. Fields. We are overall 17 fields. Okay. Now, so this is the internal table we will create by SAP itself during the execution of every program. What is the name of this internal table? Screen internal table. Since it is created based on what? Screen structure, it is called as what? Screen internal table. What this internal table contains? It contains the information of what? Screen elements. It contains the information of screen elements. Okay, means, okay, try to understand this. It contains what? Information of what? Screen element. So see here, when I execute, as part of my program, I have created many screen elements. I created list box, I created 3 blocks, and each block I created some checkboxes, radio buttons, labels, all those things. So when I execute, I am able to see all the elements. Why I am able to see all the elements is, let us take one by one. So assume that this is your first screen element. What is the name of this screen element? P_ABC. Try to understand. So assume that this is your first screen element. What is the name here? P_ABC. Are we able to see that list box? Yes, I am able to see the list box. Why I am able to see the list box is, by default we have a field what? Invisible field. We have a field what? Invisible. What is this? Character of what? 1. So internally this invisible will contain what? 0. By default, what is the value of invisible? 0. By default, the value of invisible is what? 0. That's why I am able to see that particular list box. What is the next element on the screen? Block. What is the name of the block? BK1. Are we able to see the block? Yes. Okay. Why we are able to see that block? Because by default, the invisible value will be what? 0. Then that block contain what? 3. checkboxes. What are the checkboxes? P underscore C1, C2, all those things. So P underscore C1 also will internally contain what value? 0. That's why I'm able to see that. Then P underscore C2 is also what? We are able to see that particular checkbox because the value is what? 0. Then P underscore C3. What is this? Again, we are able to see that. That's why assume that this value is 0. Next, we have another block now. What is that? BK2. Okay, we are able to see that. So understanding is by default, what are the elements we have created in the program? All the elements are visible by default. Now, why it is visible by default is internally that screen internal table contains what value for that invisible field? 0. Invisible is equal to 0 means the element is what? Visible. I repeat, if invisible equal to 0 means the element is visible. If invisible equal to 1 means the element is invisible. Okay, that's why these are all the names of the screen elements. They're all the names. We have many screen elements. We have 3 more radio buttons. We have 1 more block, 3 text, 3 comments like this. Okay, how many records you will have in this screen internal table? It depends upon your number of screen elements. How many records will be there in this screen internal elements? It depends on the screen. It depends on the screen elements, number of screen elements. Okay, so I repeat once again. By default, whatever we have created in the program, we are able to see. Why? Because internally, the value of the invisible field is what? 0 for every screen element. That's why we are able to see. What is my initial requirement? The moment the screen is displayed, these 3 blocks should be made invisible. Means I need to make this invisible field value to what? 1. This invisible will have either 0 or what? 1. By default, it is what? 0. Now I have to make it as what? 1. That is the requirement. Okay, means I need to update this internal table. How to update the internal table? Already we have seen. First, set the updated value in the work area, that is in the header. Referring to the header, you update the internal table by using what? Modify statement. Already we covered one example when we're discussing internal table. We use modify statement to update the internal table. So what I have to do, I need to write the logic to make those 3 blocks as what? Invisible. Means initially only this list box should be visible. The rest of the screen element should be made what? Invisible. By default I want. So where I have to write the logic? In the initialization, because this is the first event triggered whenever a selection screen is what? Displayed. So somewhere here, I'll do that. In the initialization event only, either here or here. Doesn't matter anywhere. But it should be under what? Initialization event. Okay, so see the logic here perform. I'll just write some meaningful subroutine name. Invisible blocks. Any subroutine name you can give, I gave it as invisible blocks. Let me define this subroutine. I'll choose the main program. Done. So I need to update my internal table. Which internal table I need to update? Screen internal table. How do you update the internal table? By using modify statement. Okay, I have to set these values to 1. I should not set it to 1 for all elements, only for the blocks. Only for the blocks, not for the list box, not for all the screen elements. So I need to loop the internal table. How do you update? You have to loop the internal loop at what? Screen. Actually, I have not created the screen internal table. It is internally created by what? SAP itself. Loop and what? End loop. Okay, so when I loop, what happens? Already we know. Each record will come from what? Each record will come from body to what? Header. So each record will come from body to header. So what is the record I'll get here initially? What is the first record in that? P underscore what? ABC. Okay, I'm not bothered about the other fields. What is the value of invisible by default? 0. So how do you update the internal table? First, update the work area, and then referring to the work area, update the internal table. But I should not update for all the records, no, only for those 3 blocks. So I'll say if screen hyphen, what is the field name here? Name, if screen hyphen name is equal to what? For the blocks I want, so what is the name of the blocks? BK1, BK2 and what? BK3. 3. So I'll say if p and s, if screen hyphen name equal to bk1, or I should also compare the elements in that block. What is that? Screen hyphen name is equal to, what are the elements here? P underscore C1. Or I'll say screen hyphen name is equal to, what is the next one, boss? P underscore C2. Or I'll say screen hyphen name is equal to what? P underscore C3. Or screen hyphen name is equal to second block. What is that? BK2. Or screen hyphen name equal to, what are the elements in that radio button, sir? P underscore R1. Or like this, you have to write the logic. P underscore R2, P underscore R3. BK3, what are the next labels? What are the label variable names I gave here? LB1, LB2, and what? LB3. So LB1 or what? LB2, and then what? LB3. Understood? So I'm writing the OR condition. So initially, when I loop, what is the first record here? P underscore ABC. Is it satisfying any of the if condition? No. Okay. This if condition is satisfied only for the screen element. So the if condition is not satisfied. So automatically, we are in the loop. What happens? The second record will be populated here. The second record will be populated here. The second record is populated. What is the second record? Yes. So this will be overwritten. What is the second record here? BK1, the name of the block. BK1, what is the value? Zero. By default, it is what? Zero. Okay, by default it is zero. Okay, so R means what? If either of the, any one of the conditions satisfied, it will enter the if block. So what I'll do here, I have to update screen hyphen. What is the field you have to update? Invisible equal to what? One. Why I'm in single quotes? Because here invisible is what? Character field. Na? So that's why I have to keep it in what? Single quotes. So if invisible, if screen hyphen what? Yeah, if it is either of the condition, invisible equal to one. So where it will update now? It updates in what? Work here. It updates in what? Header. Updates in what? Header. Means it will update here. So if condition is satisfied. So since if condition is satisfied, this will be modified to what? One. This will be modified to what? One. But I have to update in the body. Na? I have to update in the corresponding row in the body. So how do we do it? Already we have seen an example initially. What is that? Modify. What is the name of the internal double screen? So what it will do, SAP will have the intelligence which record it has looped. So second record has looped. So there is no change in the name. Nothing will happen. There is a change in the invisible field. So what happens now? This invisible zero will be modified to what? One. Understood? That is a job of what? Modify statement. Something like this. Modify will update what? The body of the internal table. Modify. Understood? First it updates what? Header. From header it will compare in the body and it will make the necessary changes. So like this, since we are in the loop, end for if is what? End if. So like this, what happens? Okay, the loop will be iterated. How many times it will be iterated? It depends upon the number of records in the screen internal table. How many records you'll have? We don't know. It depends on the number of screen elements. If I'm having 20 screen elements, 20 times it will repeat the, it will iterate the loop. Each time it will populate each record to header. If condition will be compared. Understood? This will compare with the header. If either of the conditions is satisfied, for those fields it will set invisible to what? One. This will update in what? Header. When I say modify, it updates what? Corresponding row. It updates corresponding row in what? Internal table. Done. So let's see whether this works or not. Okay, so the moment I start the execution, internally you'll have the screen internal table, and this event is triggered, this subroutine gets executed, we are updating the value of invisible. So when I execute, good. Oh, okay, courses, institutes is not made change. Why, boss? LB1, LB2, LB3 I give. LB3. BK3 only. Might be I need to compare with the titles also. Title also is considered as one element, so I need to compare with the title also. So somewhere here, I'll compare with the title also. Screen hyphen what? Name is equal to what is the title variable? T1 or anywhere I can write. What is the next one? T2. I'm trying to check in the serial order. T3. Let me check it now. Oh, I'm sorry. What are the names of the list boxes? P underscore R1, P underscore R2, P underscore R3. What I gave here? Correct only, na? The names of the radio buttons are what? P underscore R1, P underscore R2, P underscore R3. That's what I compared here. P underscore R1, R2. Achacha, this one. R2 and what? R3. Then LB1, LB2, LB3. Now see here, title also you have to compare. So when I execute, good. All the elements are made what? Invisible except what? Except what? Drop down list box. Because here I didn't give what? P underscore ABC. So P underscore ABC invisible value remains what? Zero. So what is the understanding? If invisible is equal to zero, element is visible. If invisible equal to one, element is what? Invisible. So we are able to make the elements what? Invisible by default. Any questions so far? So I repeat this once again. During the execution of every program, an internally created internal table is available called as what? Screen internal table. SAP will create that internal table based on what? Screen structure. What that internal table contains? It contains the information of what? Screen elements. It contains the information of screen elements. By iterating that screen internal table, we can control the appearance of the screen. Means I can make the screen elements visible, invisible, enabled, disabled, all those six. Okay. So this internal table will be available during the execution of what? Every program. During the execution of every program. Done. So what is the next requirement here? When I execute, here I'll choose this. After choosing, I'll press enter. Okay, if I press enter, then what is happening? The other blocks got what? Visible. But what is my requirement here? The moment I select only, its appropriate block should be visible. So that we'll address later on. But as of now, assume that I'll press enter. If I press enter, what should happen? Only the appropriate block should be made what? Visible. But here all the blocks are made what? Visible. It is coming to the default state. So what I'll do now? The point you have to understand is, after selecting the value, if I press enter in the drop-down list box, what is the event triggered at selection? Screen. Okay. After selecting the value in the drop down, if you press enter in that list box, the first event triggered is what? At selection screen. After triggering at selection screen, it will trigger at selection screen output. It will trigger what? At selection screen output. Okay. So I repeat once again, the moment I select the value in the list box and press enter, SAP will first trigger at selection screen event, and after that will trigger what? At selection screen output. So what is the final event which is getting triggered? At selection screen output. Okay, so we need to write the screen refreshing logic always in the final event. So what I'll do here, just try to understand. So I know that the moment I select the value, what is the event triggered? The moment I select the value and press enter, the event triggered is what? At selection screen. After at selection screen output is triggered. So see the technique here. Okay, I'll declare one variable here, data. something gv underscore flag type what I, some variable name. What is a variable name? Flag. You can take any name. I gave it as something flag because it lacked as an indicator. Default only got integer. So now see the technique here. At selection screen, okay, at selection screen. So already in the last class I told, whenever we select the value in the list box, okay, what happens? The key of the selected value, the key of the selected value will go and sit in the list box internally. Na? So what are the keys of my list box values? What are the keys? K1, K2 and what? K3. So I'll say if what is the name of the list box? If P underscore ABC is equal to what? K1, do so and so. Else if P underscore ABC is equal to what? K2, do so and so. Else if P underscore ABC is equal to what? K3, do so and so. End if. Okay. So what I'll do, I understood. The moment I select a value, and if you press enter key in that list box, what is the event triggered? At selection screen. And the key of the selected value will be captured in the list box internally. So I'm checking if the list box value is K1, what I'll do, I'll set flag value to 1. Okay. If the list box value is K2, I'll set the flag value to 2. Some indicator I'm setting. If it is third value, I'll set flag equal to what? 3. Okay. So what I'm doing in this event, depending on the selected value, I'm setting the flag value to either 1, 2, 3. After triggering this event, what is the next event triggered? At selection screen output. So two events gets triggered when you press enter key in the list box. The first event triggered is what? At selection screen. And the last event triggered is what? At selection screen output. So here I'll say at selection screen what? Output. At selection screen output. Now I'll say if gv underscore flag is equal to 1. If gv and when the flag value becomes 1, if you have selected what? First value. Na? So if you have selected first value, I have to make the first block visible. So I'll write that logic inside a subroutine. Perform. I'll give the subroutine name as visible block 1. Any name you can give, I'm giving meaningful name. Else if gv underscore flag is equal to 2, I'll call another subroutine perform what? Visible block 2. Okay. Else if gv underscore flag is equal to 3, I'll call another subroutine perform visible block 3. I need to define those subroutines. End if. So let me define the subroutines. What is the logic I have to write in this visible block 1? I have to make the block 1 elements visible. I have to make the block 1 elements visible and the rest of the elements to what? Invisible. I have to make the block 1 elements visible and the rest of the elements to what? Invisible. Okay. So see here, I'll define that subroutine somewhere at the end. I'll say what? Form. What is this? Visible block 1. End form. So what I have to do? I have to make the first block elements as what? Visible. How do you make the first block elements as visible? By setting the invisible value to what? 0. So again, same technique. What is this? Loop at screen and what? End loop. What I'll do? If screen-name is equal to what? Even the list box also should be made invisible, should be made visible only. Na? Okay, I'll not compare this. If screen-name equal to bk1 or if screen-name equal to what is the title variable t1 or if screen-name equal to what p underscore c1 checkbox, then if screen-name is equal to what p underscore what c2 or screen-name is equal to what p underscore c3. Okay, if it is block 1 or title or c1 c2 c3, what I have to do here, I'll say screen-invisible equal to what 0. Then I have to update the internal table. No, modify what? Modify screen. And I'll say what? End it. So what I'm doing, only the first block elements I'm making visible. How do you make visible? By setting the invisible to what? 0. This is the logic in my first subroutine. Then let me write the logic for the second subroutines. I have to define block 2, block 3 also. No? So So let me just copy paste and make the necessary changes. Visible block 2. Yeah, what is that block 2? BK2, T2. What is the radio buttons? R1. This is R2. And this is R3. Done. Then again, visible block 3. What is this? BK3, yeah? BK3, T3. What are the label variables? LB1. What else? LB2. And this is LB3. Done. So let me check it now. No errors. Done. Okay. Initially, okay, try to understand. Overall, how many events I handled? Three events. Initialization, at selection screen, output. Okay. So when I execute, by default, they are invisible. Now, I'll choose what? Institutes. I'll press enter. I'll press enter. Ah, what happened here again? The rest of the elements also made what? This thing. So I need to write the logic in a different way. What is that? See, in the block one, what I have to do in the block one, if the elements are these things, then I have to make these elements as visible. Otherwise, I have to make invisible. Na? So what I'll do here? Okay, here I need to write the list box name also. Otherwise, that also will be made invisible. So screen hyphen name equal to what? Equal to what? P underscore, what is the name of the list box? ABC. Let me write this logic for the rest of the things. Okay, so see the changes here. What I have to do here, if it is block one means I have to make it visible. Else, for other than these elements, what I have to do? For other than these elements, I have to keep them as what? Invisible only. Na? So I'll say what? Else, invisible is what? One. Only for these elements, you make it as visible. For the rest of the elements, you make keep that as what? Invisible. Repeat this logic for the rest of the subroutines also. So somewhere here. In the third subroutine also. Done. Let me check it now. No errors. Done. When I execute, yeah, see now, I'll choose institutes. I'll press enter. Yes. Only what happened? The institute is made what? Visible. I'll select locations. I'll press enter. Actually, I should not press enter. The moment I select, it should change. So that I'll address in the next class. I'll press enter. Yes, locations is made visible. I'll choose courses. I'll press enter. Yes, the courses is made visible. I'll choose again locations. I'll press enter. Yes, the appropriate block got what? Visible. So, understood. So, always the screen refreshing logic, you have to write it in the final event. So, understanding is, whenever I select a value in the drop-down list box and press enter key in that, what are the events triggered? At selection screen. After triggering at selection screen, what is the other event triggered at selection screen? Output. So what is the logic I'm writing here? What is the first event triggered whenever I press enter at selection screen? So already we know whenever we select a value, the key of the selected value will go and sit in the list box internally. Na? So I'm checking if the list box value is K1 means what? If the first value is selected, I'm setting flag as one. So I'm not writing the logic here for refreshing. Okay, screen refreshing logic should always be written in the final event which gets triggered. What is the final event which gets triggered? At selection screen output. That's right. In the first event, I'm just setting the indicators. So I'm setting the indicators 1, 2, 3. Then after triggering this event, what is the next event triggered? At selection screen output. So flag is 1. I'm making it as what? If flag is 1 means what is the logic I have to write? I have to make the first block elements visible. The other block elements are invisible. That's what the logic I wrote. Okay, how do you make it visible, invisible? I need to loop the screen internal table. If the screen elements belongs to block one and even the list box also should remain visible. That's the reason I have to write this also. So I'm keeping those elements visible. Other than these elements, the rest of the elements are made what? Invisible. Similar kind of logic in the other subroutines. Here block two elements are made visible. The other block elements are made invisible. The simple logic. Okay, so if you debug also, observe here, I'm putting the breakpoints. I'll put the breakpoint in the initialization event, in the at selection screen event. I'll also put the breakpoint in what? At selection screen output event. So when I execute, see what happens. The whenever I start the execution of my program, what is the first event triggered? Initialization. After triggering initialization, what is the next event triggered? At selection screen output. After triggering those two events, the selection screen is displayed. I repeat once again, before displaying the selection screen to the user for the first time, two events gets triggered. First is initialization, next is what? At selection screen output. So see here, when I say FI, see where it is stopping. Where it is stopping? First event triggered is what? Initialization. I am not interested to debug, so I'll say F8. When I say F8, control jumps to the next event. So when I say F8, yes, it is going to what? At selection screen output. So what is the understanding? Before showing the selection screen to the user, two events got triggered. One is initialization, next is what? At selection screen output. So in the at selection screen output, what is the default value for flag? Initially zero. No? So none of the if conditions are what? Satisfied. So nothing will happen in that selection screen output. By default, those three blocks are what? Invisible. Done. Now I'll select a value. I'll select locations. I'll press enter. What is the event triggered? At selection screen, yes. And which value I selected? Locations. Na? So what is the name of the list box internally? K3. Understood? And if you see the flag value still is what? Zero. So when I say F5, first if condition is failed. Second else also is failed. Third else is satisfied. The ABC value is what? K3, because I selected the third value. GV underscore flag is marked to what? 3. Yes. See here, GV underscore flag is marked to 3. After executing at selection screen, where the control goes to the at selection screen output. So when I say F8, yes, you can see here, control is going to what? At selection screen output. Okay. So it is checking the flag value. What is the flag value? 3. First if condition is failed. Second else is also failed. Third else is satisfied. What I am doing here? I am calling the subroutine visible block 3. What is the logic I wrote here? I am looping the screen internal table. I am making the third element, third block elements visible, and the other elements is what? Invisible. So I am not interested to debug this. I'll say F8. Done. I got it. Okay. So here we are following a little lengthy process in the sense. Every time I'm comparing each and every element, instead of doing that, I can group it. So that grouping concept we'll discuss tomorrow. And the other thing I have to address is, the moment I select this, the appropriate block should be visible. I should not press enter. So that point, that part, I'll cover it in the tomorrow's session. Any questions for today, please ask me. I'll try to share the recording by afternoon. Okay, so try to practice so that you can understand the tomorrow session. Tomorrow session also almost similar to this, but we are going to focus on some other thing, like how to make it elements visible, invisible the moment I do the selection without pressing enter key, and instead of checking each and every element, can we group them? How to group, how to do screen grouping, that part we'll discuss tomorrow. Done. Any questions? Right, so chalo then. So I'll wind off. We'll continue tomorrow. Okay. Chalo then. So I'm winding off.